starting with the injuries of the two bones that we studied before, which are the hip bone and femur. First of all, let me tell you some important points that can be given in the MCQs by the University of Health Sciences in the professional exams. Regarding some clinical significant points regarding the lower limb injuries, you must know that what age group is prone or vulnerable to lower limb injuries. So, adolescence. I hope you would know this term, adolescence. We know that different age-related terms that we use to describe the different age groups of human beings. One of them is adolescence. You must have heard adults or teenagers and child. So this is the stage when a child is basically entering into his or her adult life. And the age group usually comes in the teens or late teens, that is up till the 17 years of age. Adolescents, this is the age group that is most vulnerable to lower limb injuries. Why? Because of the natural reasons, their musculoskeletal system is immature at this stage. So if a strain is put on these immature joints and muscles, like, for example, in certain athletic games like sprinting, athletic games, athletic marathons, football, soccer. So when the pressure is put on these immature muscles and bones, this may lead to different types of conditions, pathological conditions related with the bones and muscles. One of such conditions is called osteochondrosis. Now, what is osteochondrosis? Osteochondrosis involves irritation and injury of the epiphyseal plates in the developing bones. Again, one of the conditions associated with the adolescent age group due to excessive exercise, excessive running, or excessive gaming, physical gaming, may lead to osteochondrosis. Now, let's move on to more important topic, which is the hip bone injuries. Let me tell you a very common false term that is associated with the injuries of the hip bone. Pelvic fracture is a misleading term commonly associated with the injuries of the hip bone. So you must know the difference between pelvic fractures and hip bone injuries. Hip bone injuries are usually labeled by the layman as pelvic fracture, when in reality that layman may be suffering from the hip bone injuries. Pelvic fracture, in the pelvic fractures, which bone is usually fractured or is truly fractured? That is the femur. So on many occasions, the layman describes his femoral fractures as pelvic fracture and can be confused with the hip bone injuries. So you must know the difference between the pelvic fracture, in which usually femur bone is the one that is fractured, and the hip bone injuries. So, what are the different fractures associated with the hip bone? We have avulsion fractures, and then we have certain fractures leading to conditions called coxa vara and coxa valga. Avulsion fractures, as the name is self-explanatory, avulsion means torn away, being torn away, right? Phat jana, ek cheez ka dusre se phat jana. So what actually gets torn away? Muscles and ligaments attached at certain bony landmarks on the hip bone. They are being torn away again as a result of either direct trauma or indirect trauma. So avulsion means being torn away, and avulsion fractures are associated with the hip bone on such bony landmarks which give rise to or which give attachment to either ligaments or muscles. One of such commonly avulsed bony landmarks include anterior superior iliac spine, which you know from your previous knowledge about the attachments on hip bone. Sartorius and rectus femoris are the muscles attached on the anterior superior iliac spine. So if sartorius and rectus femoris, they experience excessive pull on their muscle fibers, they might lead to the avulsion of the anterior superior iliac spine from the hip bone, iliac crest. Hamstrings are associated with the ischial tuberosity. They get attached on the ischial tuberosity. Here you can see in this diagram. I hope all the diagrams are clear to you. They get attached over the ischial tuberosity. So hamstrings, when they are again excessively used in any activity that involves their excessive pulling, will lead to the avulsion of the bony part from the ischial tuberosity. Similar is the case with the iliopsoas getting attached over the lesser trochanter of the femur. So here in this diagram, you can see various points with muscles or ligaments attached on them. And if they experience excessive pull on their fibers, they will lead to the tearing of those bony landmarks on which they are attached. So I hope avulsion fractures of the hip bone are clear to you. Let's move on to next topic, which is very important from examination point of view. It is commonly given in the MCQs. It is commonly asked in the short essay answers. Again, that thing has started. So here we have two conditions associated with coxa valga and coxa vara. As you can see in this diagram, I hope the diagrams are clear to you, both this one and the X-ray. These conditions are associated with the angle of inclination. And you know what is angle of inclination? The long axis of the neck of femur with the long axis of the shaft of the femur. The angle formed between these two axes is called angle of inclination. So whatever condition leads to decreased or increased angle, they are commonly called coxa valga, that is the increased angle, and coxa vara, decreased angle. Beta, you must remember one thing. Angle of inclination is variable, or it has some variable factors associated with it. And what are those variables associated with the angle of inclination? Angle of inclination may vary with age of the person, gender of the person, and the development of the femur, as well as pathology. I hope this point is clear to you. So it is clear to us that the angle of inclination can be affected by the age of the patient. For example, in old age, there can be a different angle of inclination as compared to the young age. Similar is the case with the infants and the children. Their angle of inclination at that time of the their life period can be different from later on in their lives, adult life. Similarly, some pathology can also lead to the decrease or increase in the angle of inclination. And one such example I have put on here. This is an X-ray of a child, and the condition shown in this X-ray is rickets. You know the cases of rickets by the bending of the bones. A child's bone being bent on either side, especially in the lower limbs. They are showing bowing or bent bones. And what is the condition called? Rickets. It is associated with the childhood ages. Okay. To move on further, we should know what does valga and vera mean. As you know, in coxa valga, angle of inclination is increased. But like in this case, you can see, angle of inclination has increased so that the component involved in this angle, the distal component involved in this angle, and in this case, by the distal component or element, I mean femur, shaft of the femur. So in valga, shaft of the femur, which is the distal element in this angle of inclination, is shown to be deviated away from the midline, right? What happens in vera? Vera may, the distal element, that is again the shaft of the femur in this case, is pulled towards the midline. I hope this is clear to you. What happens to the shaft of the femur or the distal elements in both these conditions, coxa valga and coxa vera? So next we move on to the fractures of the femur. In the femur, at its different parts, fractures can take place. So we have categorized the fractures of the femur according to the part involved. Upper end has its own features, fractures. Okay, fine. Upper end has transcervical, intertrochanteric, and greater trochanter fractures, whereas the shaft of the femur has spiral fracture, and distal end has a fracture which involves the condylar separation. So let's look in the diagram on the right side. These are the two fractures commonly associated with the upper end of the femur. So this one that is passing through the midline of the neck of the femur, that is called transcervical. Whereas this fracture line, which is running from greater trochanter to the lesser trochanter, is called intertrochanteric fracture. And also fracture of the greater trochanter may also occur in the upper end of the femur. Another common fracture associated with the upper end of the femur is also called intracapsular fracture of the neck of the femur. We shall be covering that inshallah with the hip joint. Transcervical and intertrochanteric fractures, how do they occur? They usually occur by the direct trauma that one can experience in such cases as slipping on a step of a ladder or staircase, and may lead to the overriding of the two fractured segments over each other. Similarly, fracture of the greater trochanter can also take place as a result of direct trauma, like in motor vehicle accidents. In the spiral fracture, here in the x-ray on the left side, you can see spiral fracture of the shaft of the femur, and you can see the two segments overriding each other. This condition can lead to the shortening of the lower limb. On the right side is a figure showing different types of fractures taking place at the distal end of the femur. So we have condylar separation here in this diagram. We have supracondylar fractures, and then we have bicondylar fractures, the fracture line passing between the two condyles of the femur. The fractures of the distal end are commonly associated with the loss of blood supply to the lower limb. Now moving on to the compartment syndrome and fasciotomy. From our knowledge of compartment syndrome from the upper limb, we know that compartment syndrome occurs because of increased pressure caused by any pathology associated with the one of the structures in the compartment, in that particular compartment. Due to the introduction of some pathogen or inflammation, this can lead to the accumulation of the fluid. Like in this diagram on the right side, you can see the swollen leg. This is one of the presentations of a compartment syndrome. All right? Compartment syndrome. And from your previous knowledge, you know that what are the sign symptoms and why are they produced due to the compartment syndrome. Compartment syndrome ultimately leads to the pressure on the neurovasculature of that particular compartment, leading to paralysis of the muscle as a result of nerve compression and ischemia due to the loss of blood supply. Physiotomy is the treatment that is adopted to relieve this compression. And what do we do in a physiotomy? We basically make an incision in the deep fascia and one of its intermuscular septum to release the pressure from the compartment. Sepsis. Now we can move on to the injuries or clinical conditions associated with the muscles. So very important condition is called psoas abscess. It is associated, as the name is indicating, with the psoas major muscle that arises from the sides of the bodies of the 12th thoracic vertebra up till 5th lumbar vertebra and their transverse processes. And along with iliacus muscle gets attached over the lesser trochanter of the femur. On the right side, you can see a radiological picture of this condition, that is psoas abscess. What happens in the psoas abscess? It is associated with the tuberculosis of the vertebral column. When the pathogen spreads in the body, leading to the abscess formation in the soft part of the body, especially in the psoas muscle, since it is associated or nearest to the vertebral column. Normally what happens in an x-ray, we can see the lateral border of the muscle. But look on the this side, on the contralateral side, here is a, you can see the picture is obscured. So here is the abscess that is obscuring the psoas muscle on this side. Whereas psoas muscle lateral border, we can see over this side. So the clinical presentation can be clearly seen in the radiological evidence, where the lateral border of the psoas major muscle is obscured. Next condition related with the muscle is called a rider's strain, that is adductor longus muscle strain on the adductor longus muscle. Strain of this muscle is commonly associated with the horseback riders. And here is a picture showing the excessive pulled adductor longus muscle. It can lead to the pain that can be referred to the knee joint and in the leg. And commonly associated with the horseback riders. Excessive use of adductor longus muscle by these riders can also lead to the development of rider's bones, which are the calcifications that develop due to the excessive use of this muscle by the horseback riders. Femoral artery, clinicals associated with the femoral artery are very important from both examination and clinical point of view. Femoral artery can be used for multiple purposes. Why? Because in the upper part of its course, just below the inguinal ligament, it is superficial. So here it is easily accessible for palpation, taking the pulse, as well as catheterization for various purposes. So 2 centimeter around, or less than 2 centimeter, just below the inguinal ligament, we can palpate the femoral artery. It is accessible for the catheterization, and also taking the sample for of the arterial blood that we often require in pulmonary conditions. And to palpate the femoral artery, you will have to put your little finger on the anterior superior iliac spine and thumb on the pubic symphysis so that your palm will lie on the or will be in direct contact with the femoral artery, the part of the artery that is superficial. Femoral vein, as you know, lies further medial to the artery, and it can be used for the cannulation. And during cannulation, we can introduce air embolism right into the vein. And these small air bubbles can lead to the clot formation within the pulmonary vasculature of the lung, leading to further complications. This